Gentlemen, and welcome to our annual Patriot Day program. In front of you are the pillars of the greatest generation. These are the values of a generation of men and women who were born between 1914 and 1930. They are the people who grew up in the Great Depression. They are the people who fought in World War II, who understand the meaning of sacrifice in terms of material possessions and also in real blood, sweat, and tears. They are the humble men and women who never brag about what they've done or what they've been through. They are loyal, patriotic, and level-headed. They aren't made of different stuff than we are, but they face greater hardships and challenges and always rose to the challenge. They are our fathers, our great-grandfathers, and our great-great-grandfathers. And they were perfect. They weren't perfect by any means, but they were a cut above the rest. You can't measure their art of manliness scientifically, but you can sense it when you're around them. You see it in their old pictures. Some say they just don't make them like they used to. Today we are honored to have one of those men with us. His name is Major Eric Zadny. He's not only a veteran of World War II, he's also served in the Korean War and the Vietnam War. We would like to extend a special warm welcome to you, Major Zadny, today because you are a member of our greatest generation. The color guard will now lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
five gridirons, Jack Dempsey wore the ring, and the Yankee Stadium is the house that Ruth built. They would give us Joe DiMaggio, the Yankee Clipper, Joe Louis, the Brown Bomber, and a big band swing. But more importantly, they would teach Americans a personal responsibility, a sense of duty, faith, and honor. This, the greatest generation, would suffer through the Great Depression, an experience that would serve them well, in meeting the oncoming storm that would soon threaten the world. But who are these people that make up our greatest generation? They're your grandparents and your great-grandparents. They're the ones who are so often taken for granted because they're always there to lend a hand, give advice, or an embrace just when you need it. But what made them so different from other Americans of other times? We think we know a small part of their story. Could they truly know who they were? You would have to live it.
Stay. lost confidence.
No! We can cover it up with some of our funds so it doesn't look so bad people in panic!
Could you look at this? It's too massive! We can't cover this!
Who'll do that? The fundamental business of the country, that is the production and distribution of commodities and sale!
No, he's right! Look at the ticker tape! We'll lose everything! All of us is in the market! We're ruined!
We're doomed!
And see!
What about the people? Who lose their jobs? Their homes? Who lose everything?
Everybody's folks. Everybody's empty. I am getting off.
Who
for what them dust has done to the land, the tenant system don't work no more. They don't even break even, much less show a profit. Why, one man in the traffic can handle 12 or 14 of these places. You just pay him a wage and take all the profit.
Yeah, but we couldn't do on any less than what our share is now. Well, the children ain't getting enough to eat as it is. And they're so ragged. We'd be ashamed if everybody else's children weren't the same way.
I can't help that. All I know is I got my orders. They told me to tell you to get off, and that's what I'm telling you.
You mean get off my own land?
Now, don't blame me. It ain't my fault.
Whose fault is it?
You know who owns the land, the Shawnee Land and Cattle Company.
And who's the Shawnee Land and Cattle Company?
It ain't nobody. It's a company.
They got a president, ain't they? They got some of you knows what a shotgun's for, ain't they?
Oh, son, it ain't his fault because the bank tells him what to do.
All right. Where's the bank?
Tulsa. What's the use of picking on him? He ain't nothing but the manager. And he's half crazy himself trying to keep up with his orders from the east.
Then who knew he shoot?
Brother, I don't know. If I did, I'd tell you. I just don't know who's to blame.
I'm right here to tell you, mister, there ain't nobody gonna push me off my land. My grandpa took up this land 70 years ago. My pa was born here. We was all born on it. And some of us was killed on it.
Some of us died on it. That's what makes it hard. You born on it, and working on it, and dying on it, and not no piece of paper with a writing on it.
Well, what happened?
They came. They came and pushed me off. They came with the cats.
The what?
Cats. Calico tractors.
After that,
head, I don't know. What will any of us do?
Indeed, what was the fate of the common man in America? The Great Depression was upon them. Millions lost their jobs, millions lost their homes, millions were going hungry.
My brother and I rode the freight to Oklahoma. They walked 13 miles through the woods till we came to a cabin of black jackals. We asked if we could have a bucket of water. The man asked, what did we last eat?
We told him and he told us about to bring soup. He said it was down in milk, a pint of cornbread, and a bucket of sorghum on the left.
The boat was blinking the last was full of tiny ants.
Shush! We were glad to have a lid up on it.
We sure can want the lady's cornbread.
Have you seen my daughter? She had told me that she was a burden to me. Thousands of young people have fled their families, ashamed of poverty. I knew life was hard for her, and the morning that we awoke, we worried about something to eat. After breakfast, we worried about a place to go, and when it started to get dark, we worried about a place to sleep.
How did these Americans survive this? 9,000 banks have failed. Billions have been lost in deposits. Unemployment soared to unthinkable levels, and an army of migrants fled their home with nowhere to go. But this generation of Americans didn't despair. They didn't give up, and they found ways to help one another and make do.
William Aldridge recalled a lifelong memory. He knocked on a stranger's door and asked a pretty girl for a cup of water. She gave him a glass of water and some bread. As he walked down by the railroad tracks, a brakeman smiled from the corner and said, "Go get yourself a meal, kid."
Paul Cooker was driving the rails trying to get home to escape Buzzball of life. He arrived in Milwaukee, weeping hungry, lips gasped, and sunburned thirst. He got the train to Chicago. An angel in the form of an 8-year-old woman touched his hand and asked if he needed help. He told her his story. She pressed a dollar bill to the palm of his hand and said, "God bless you, son."
The Tackett family lived in Virginia near Berkus Town Grade. Every time the train stopped, 16 hobos got off and came to their home and asked for food. There's five in the family. When Grandpa saw the hobos, he alerted Mother to making egg sandwiches and packing bags of fruit and vegetables. He'd always have some kind of work for them to do. Pick bugs from the garden, fetch water from the spring, or chop wood. In 20 minutes, the hobos would be back on the train with a good meal in hand.
The Depression years carried on. People often lifted their spirits with music.
Yeah!
He called it the New Deal.
A host of unemployed citizens face the grim problem of existence, a savings of many years and thousands of families is gone. Only the forced outlets can deny the stark realities of the moment. This nation is asking for action, and action now. Our greatest primary task is to put people to work. Happiness lies in the mere possession of money, lies in the joy of achievement, the thrill of creative effort, and moral stimulation of work. Let me assert my firm belief, the only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
Tonight, over the peaceful roads of Belgium and France, millions are now fleeing from their homes to escape the bombs and gunfire. Without shelter or food, they stumble on not knowing where the end of the road would be. I speak to you because each one of you listening tonight has a way of helping them. The American Red Cross represents each of us in rushing food, clothing, and supplies to these destitute people. Let's sit down together again, you and I, and consider our own pressing problems that confront us. There are many of us who in the past have closed our eyes to events in our good faith of what some of their fellow Americans told them, that what is taking place in Europe is none of our business. And no matter what happens over there, the United States could always preserve its peaceful course in the world. For those of you who have closed your eyes for any reason, the events of the past 2 weeks have shattered those illusions and warned of the coming storm. I'm certain that out of the heart of every man, woman, and child in this land, prayer goes out to Almighty God that suffering, starving, destruction may end, and peace return to the world.
President Roosevelt was right. The troubles in Europe began to worsen. Adolf Hitler had already conquered much of Western Europe and had now set his sights on America's greatest ally, England.
Thank you.
The decade of the 1930s had been hard on Americans, but the youth of the greatest generation had survived the Great Depression and were none the worse for the wear. The decade had taught them and taught them lessons about life that will become invaluable in the coming years. On Saturday, December the 6th, at about 1:07 p.m., on the East Coast, most Americans were listening to the radio, local programming like the news, farm reports, game shows, music contests, and children's programming flooded the airwaves. Some people were at the movies. In those days, most Americans went to the movies twice a week, and on this day, they were probably taking in Citizens Kane, Maltese Falcon, or perhaps Dumbo. They knew about the conflict in Europe, but probably weren't thinking about it on that Saturday afternoon. The Brooklyn Football Dodgers were playing the New York Giants that day, and
the Dodgers are ready to kick off. They just scored. Ace Carter did it. John Lomas boys lead the Giants 7-0. Travers comes up. He loops it. It's a long one down the 3-yard line. Ward tries to kick. He's overslept. He's over 10. Nice block made by 11. He's still going. He's up to the 25. Now he's hitting it hard at the 27-yard line.
This is this broadcast to bring you the supporting bulletin for United Press. Flash, Washington. The White House announces Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. Stay tuned to WOR for further development, which will be broadcast immediately as this evening.
true, Mary's still trapped in Arizona.
We can hear tapping inside the hole. Do everything we can to get them, sir.
We've been trained to think that we're invincible, and our prize ships have been destroyed by an enemy considered inferior. We're on the ropes, gentlemen. This is exactly why I need to strike back now.
We're preparing an attack on that submersion of islands.
I'm talking about Hangar Japan. What did they do to us?
Mr. President, Pearl Harbor fought us anywhere because we didn't face the facts. This is no time to ignore them. The Army Air Group says long-range bombers are no place to launch them. Midway's too far, and Russia won't let us strike from there.
Admiral, the Navy's planes are small. They carry light loads in that short range. We would have to get them within a few miles of Japan and therefore risk our carriers. And if we lose our carrier, sir, we will have no shield against invasion.
Mr. President, sir, the Admiral's right. Japan has decimated our ability to strike back immediately. We need time to prepare, sir.
Does anyone in this room think that victory is possible without facing danger? We are at war. Of course there is a risk.
Let us consider the risk, Mr. President. If the Japanese invade us now, they will penetrate as far as Chicago before we stop them.
Gentlemen, most of you didn't know me when I used my legs. I was strong, proud, and arrogant. Now I've wondered ever out of my life why God put me in this chair. But when I see defeat in the eyes of my countrymen, in your eyes right now, I start to think that maybe you brought me down. In times like these, we all need to be reminded who we truly are. We'll not give up or give in.
Mr. President, with all due respect, sir, what you're asking, it can't be done.
Get back! Do not tell me it can't be done.
Mr. Vice President, Mr. Speaker, members of the Senate and House of Representatives, yesterday, December 7, 1941, a day that will live in infamy, the United States was suddenly and deliberately attacked by the naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval military forces. I regret to tell you that many American lives have been lost. As Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy, I direct all measures we came for our defense, but always will our nation remember the character of Gonzalez against us. No matter how long it may take to overcome this premeditated invasion, American people and their righteous might will win through absolute victory.
Soon, every American will know that over 2,000 of our countrymen have perished in a Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, and that half of our Navy fleet have been destroyed. President Roosevelt took a nation stock of his isolationism and innocence that in order to win this war, every man, woman, and child will have to become part of the fight.
Never before have we been called upon for such a prodigious effort. Never before have we lived so little time and should do so much.
In 1941, America was not a superpower. Our utmost right connecting to the world is institutes still in the grip of a lingering depression. The war will change all that, but also unite the country in a way it's never been so before or since.
To understand the American home front, you have to understand the texture of the times. A time so naive that most Americans didn't even know their own president was put in war. A time where it took war news 2 weeks to get to the newsreels. A survival of democracy was by no means assured.
The world had become a very dark place. Japan and Germany had declared war on America, and German U-boats were sinking our tankers right off the coast of New Jersey and Florida, and had been sighted by bailiffs at both beaches. The oceans had once kept America invulnerable, had been penetrated by enemies from both the east and the west.
Our fathers rushed off to war. Volunteers shed their civilian identities and were rushed to training camps at night of grocers from Kansas to mechanics from Detroit. Within 6 months, many would be sent to battlefields around the world.
Hi, Captain Mary.
Hi, boys. Why don't you come and get sweetheart.
She sure is.
Captain Mary, she's so
to show the Japanese that we would hit back.
Peace, the Lord, living in freedom. Almighty God. Amen.
This flag is for Matt. And this flag is for George.
This flag is for Al.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
Thank you.
that. Songs like G.I. Jive, Waiting for the Train to Come In, or Well, You'll See.
Well, you and the world are talking about
allied terms. Repeating this bulletin, dated San Francisco, the Federal Administration using the force of Gomai saying, Japan accepts allied terms. This is not official. I repeat, this is not official. This is from the Tokyo Radio.
Corporal Sterling Ralph Renner, Transportation Acrobat. Sergeant Donald Leroy Maker, Prisoner of War, Sergeant First Class, Pacific Theater.
PSC Edward Kuaskin, Glider Chipper, 101st Airborne, European Theater.
Corporal P. Patricia, Post Artillery, European Theater.
Staff Sergeant Joseph T. Kennedy, U.S. Army, European Theater.
Sergeant John Joseph DeCassie, U.S. Army, European Theater.
Sergeant Michael Lamont, U.S. Army, European Theater.
Captain Jack James Kenneth Rutherford, U.S. Air Force, European Theater.
Corporal Fort Burton, U.S. Army, European Theater. Sergeant Adrian Sandy Rose, U.S. Marine Corps, Pacific Theater.
PFC Philip Richard LaBarba, U.S. Army, Pacific Theater.
PFC Vincent Serrano, U.S. Army, Pacific Theater.
Thomas Hewitt Van Winkle, U.S. Army, 110th Field Artillery, 1st Battalion, 29th Division, European Theater.
Corporal James M. Klein, 4th Armored Division, European Theater.
Sergeant Alfonso Alfonsis Rodriguez, U.S. Army, European Theater.
Major R. Exactly, 187th Parachute Infantry Regiment, 11th Airborne Division, U.S. Army, European Theater. 187th Combat Team, Korean Theater. 77th Special Forces Group, Airborne Fighter Group, Airborne Infantry, 82nd Airborne Division, Project Delta, 5th Special Forces Group, SMG Studies and Observation Group, Vietnam.
Combat Infantry Act, 2 Legion of Merit Medals, 4 Bronze Stars, 4 Purple Hearts with 3 Oak Leaf Clusters, 4 Army Commendation Joint Service Companies, Warring Distinguished Service Corps, Air Medal, 3 Gold Medal, Master Parachutes, 4 Parachutes, Aircraft crewman's planes and the good conference.
We would like to present Major Eric Zaki with our very own SGA Greatest Generation Medal.
Thank you.
everybody. It is my happy privilege to introduce a new song, God Bless America.
like to thank Mr. Schinelli once again for his expertise with our military props.